It's not easy being green. Having to spend its day in the color of the leaves. When it could be nicer being red, yellow or gold. Something much more colorful like that.
Greetings and welcome to Green TV. I'm your host, David Kaiser, and joining me today is Marty Lucas. Marty is a lawyer who's been focused on property and environmental law and comes to us from North Judson, Indiana. Marty, welcome, and thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Dave.
It's our pleasure, truly. Marty, tell us how a law career evolves over time to focus on environmental property law issues.
Well, I suppose I didn't really have control over that. It seemed to have been some kind of destiny for me, actually, because I started out, my interest in the environment goes back to my family growing up in rural North Judson area on our farm, which you can still find online, BigEastern.com, a place called the Big Eastern. And it's just a really nice part of the countryside, and I really began to appreciate it more when I went to college and really realized what I had there. And so after graduating from law school, I decided to go back to North Judson and practice law there. And over time, I began to see lots of other people who were property owners and really cared about the land that they lived on or that their family had owned for maybe a long time and taking care of it for the future, and that they need legal representation. And that environmental law too often means working for a big corporation to find a way to trash the environment, but there needed to be some lawyers who worked for people who were trying to protect the environment as well.
Now, was there a particular case or a particular issue that motivated you or that got you involved wholeheartedly? Was there a catalyst for making the transition into that type of law somewhere in your past?
Well, there is, and it happened long before I was ever a practicing attorney. It happened when, once again, I was a child, and the drainage board decided to go through a creek on our farm, and that it needed to be dredged. And they bulldozed every tree along that creek, and they dredged it out, and I don't think it had any beneficial impact anywhere, and I was really shocked by that experience. I guess that must have been in the 60s.
Sure.
There was a lot of the shocking things the government was doing in the 60s, and that was only one of them. It hit me close to home, but I will tell you that a lot of people, I think, are brought into an interest in this when it's brought to home by a bulldozer going down the bank of a creek or a river they love, or a creek or a river they love being polluted, and all of a sudden they realize it's something that, you know, really they are involved in whether they want to be or not.
I guess. So the seed comes from a long way back. That's an interesting
Indeed. Story.
How have you helped landowners deal with environmental issues that relate to their, you know, the lakes and the streams and the rivers that they have on their lands? How does this interest actually manifest itself in the kind of work that you do?
Well, how do you practice environmental law for the benefit of landowners who want to enhance, preserve, and improve riparian or other aquatic rights and, you know, values on their property? One of the key things is that you have to look back into the history of the law a little bit.
Okay.
Because we presently live in a time when we tend to think of environmental protection as being a governmental project. We think of regulators, and I think we should support our regulators, but we also have rights as individual property owners that go back to even to the Middle Ages. In the Middle Ages, you weren't allowed to pollute the water upstream from downstream from your neighbor. In other words, you couldn't pollute the water and cause your neighbor downstream problems. That's one of what's called riparian rights. You also couldn't divert a source of water away from a person who was maybe running a mill or something of that nature, because you know, creeks and rivers and lakes had a great deal of value to the property owners in the Middle Ages, and so that area of law built up. Now, over time, during the 20th century, because government came in and began to regulate these, we began to think of the government handling these issues. But, you know, many of these rights that you have as a property owner who owns land on a river or a lake, many of these rights still exist. And so you can take action on your own to help preserve the quality, quantity, and any condition related to that river, stream, or lake that you have property on under riparian rights doctrine.
Wow. Well, give us myself and our our viewers out there, give us a for instance on how that manifests itself, a case that you're aware of where somebody who is a landowner either had some impending disaster coming to his piece of water, lake, or stream, and how the legal system intervenes and what kind of outcome. Yes, I'm looking for a scenario that I can understand that'll set a nice example for our viewers out there.
Well, I can give you an example of the case I'm working on right now.
Okay, great.
In the St. Joseph Valley, I'm representing several parties, including Acres Inc. and several communities in Noble County and LaGrange County, who are opposing an effort to convert the Elkhart River's upper reaches into a regulated drain. Much of the Elkhart River is, especially the upper reaches, there are sections that qualify under Indiana's wild and scenic rivers, and there are very few rivers in fact in the state that do qualify for that. And this is important tributary of the St. Joe, for one, and it's also important because the St. Joe is part of the Great Lakes system. But what's being done there is a coalition of wide-ranging group of people, including conservancy districts, communities, towns, and cities, and a couple of not-for-profit environmental organizations, including Acres and the Isaac Walton League of Indiana, have all joined together to resist an effort to convert this currently wild river into a regulated drain. Now, the conversion itself won't cause any environmental consequences, but the trouble is that once that river is under the jurisdiction of the drainage code, it becomes a regulated drain by law rather than a river. Mm-hmm. And as a drain,
yeah,
it's subject to all these controls of the drainage board, which typically are, I just invite anyone to read the drainage code, it's a very anti-environmental law, which can support all kinds of activities like dredging the river, bulldozing the banks, and spraying the banks with chemicals, and then also it creates a new tax on all the landowners in the watershed to pay for that, and that's an important thing to understand.
Wow. So by changing a semantics, by changing the designation of a river, you open up a whole new basket of regulations and rules that apply to it that maybe have nothing to do with keeping it functioning as a river. It sounds like to me they can bulldoze the banks, tear the trees down, and turn it into just another water collection system, when in fact it's a very important piece of our ecosystem.
It's called a regulated drain. It's called a ditch.
Yeah.
You know, it's no longer the Elkhart River, it's the Elkhart Ditch, basically. I mean, this is the case with the Kankakee. Anybody from my part of the state is familiar with the Kankakee. Now, the dredging of the Kankakee had no doubt some beneficial aspects. It did create lots of valuable farmland, lots of productive farmland. I don't ever want to downplay that. But on the other hand, environmental benefits that the Kankakee River had have really been reduced. The wildlife production, the potential for recreation, a large lake, English Lake, one of the largest lakes in Indiana, was drained, and as we all know, lakefront property is valuable. So even if you don't care about the environment, if you just care about money, there's lakefront property, much of it, that was lost in the course of that. So the problem that I have with the drainage code is that it was created in the 1960s. It doesn't value environmental uses of rivers and streams to which it applies at all. In many ways, if you read it, and I think many people make this mistake, they read this and they think, well, this is going to apply to the ditch that runs through my neighboring farmer's field. And applied in that context, it's not too bad, or it's even reasonable, although maybe we've progressed a little since the 60s. But applied in the context of a river like a canoeing stream, like one of the branches of the Elkhart River, or perhaps the Tippecanoe River, it really is not acceptable environmentally, I don't think, in our present context. But yet, Indiana has not substantially altered this drainage code. And like I always say, people say, well, why is it like that? Well, it's not called the Water Resources Management Code. If it balanced the various competing interests, that would be that would be a lot more useful, but right now it's heavily stilted in favor of getting rid of water. It's called drainage.
How do we reestablish that balance or establish that balance? How do you impact that? How can people like our viewers impact that? How can we get involved to help support that balance? You mentioned earlier, support your regulators. I'm wondering if you can expand on that a little bit and tell me exactly what you mean by that, and then relate that to protecting these resources.
Yes, I think one of the problems that we have in Indiana in particular is that our regulators are underpaid, underappreciated, and they're a little demoralized at times, in fact. And I've really found that it's helpful to contact the regulators that are involved in a particular issue and help them with information, support them in their efforts to do their job, and even when it hurts a little. For example, one of the cases I'm handling, a person has a wetland on their property that they've been trying to preserve, and a neighbor has been trying to drain it, and it totally. Now, clearly this wetland has some impacts on the neighbor, and they don't like it, and that there's no question about that. The problem has been trying to establish what elevation that ought to go at. Now, my client would like to have one elevation, and the neighbor would like to have no water at all, a representative from IDAM studied the question and came up with an elevation that reduced it more than my client would have liked, but would preserve the resources on it, would preserve the fish, the wildlife, mm-hmm. which is abundant at this location. And we took the position that we were going to support that IDAM decision, even though we would have liked a little more water. And they were a little surprised by it. They were a little surprised that we said, no, we're with you. You compromised, you made a fair compromise, and we're going to support you. And that really helped us all the way through. And I recommend that to a lot of people in these situations. If you can get the regulators to do something for you to help preserve the environment, then support them on that.
Right.
You know, does that make sense?
Yeah, that's wonderful. That's a great example of our great democracy working, when they're both heavy hands realize that they have to have a middle ground, and working to the middle ground, and then living with it and supporting it. One of the issues that the St. Joe Valley Greens have been involved in relates to rainwater sewage, water runoff, raw sewage, and how it all runs together into our St. Joseph River. In fact, a show that we did previously addressed that issue in its entirety. Tell us a little bit about the CSO issue as you see it and its impact environmentally.
Well, Indiana, you know, has to lead the nation in something, and so I guess we lead the nation in CSO. It's not a very good thing to lead the nation in. One of the things I always point out about water resources in Indiana, it's a little background, I guess, in a way. I always say abundance breeds contempt. We have a wonderfully abundant supply of water, of wonderful, I just came over the St. Joe River on the way here. What a beautiful river. What a fine river. I mean, it's really something special that we have rivers like that. Out west, you know, they have maybe two rivers that size.
Right.
I don't know, something like that. And here we have lots of them. And so people don't really pay the attention to them, perhaps, that they should. And that's led to the CSO problem. And of course, it's partly because our towns and cities grew up at times when these things weren't considered that big of a problem. And as I'm sure you covered before, the source of it is that we have lots of areas, older parts of our towns and cities, where there's not a separation between sewers, you know, septic sewers and storm sewers. So rainwater events, typically snow melt or rain, can cause sewer systems to be mm-hmm. overwhelmed, mm-hmm. and raw sewage ends up getting dumped into the rivers. And this is really, mm-hmm. very unhealthy, and it can be expensive to fix, though. Some communities in Indiana are making good progress on it. I can just, from my area, one community that might surprise you, Knox, not known for being
okay.
honestly, not necessarily the most progressive place, you wouldn't think.
Right.
But in this case, they've had good leadership, and there are no CSOs in Knox. So I invite
Wonderful.
The rest of Michiana to catch up with Knox.
They sure.
have no CSOs.
There
Wonderful. Are other, it was a little easier there, but it was highly significant in Knox because that's where the Yellow River goes through, which is one of the tributaries of the Kankakee, and it's in good condition. It's a nice smallmouth river, not real well known. Maybe some of you fishermen want to try it out. But when you have a smaller river, the impacts are more obvious.
Sure.
Now, then you got a situation like South Bend. Now, according to the South Bend Tribune article I read recently, they've reduced the total amount from 14 million gallons a year to 1 million gallons a year. Well, that helps, right?
Right.
That's a big improvement at $80 million. And of course, like probably most things, the cost, the marginal cost of cleaning it up, the next step may be incremental. It may go up, if you see what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Perfection is more expensive. And probably the river can handle a little bit of sewage once in a while. It's not desirable. But it's a big river, right. And you know the ability of a river to handle effluent relates to the total size of the river and how much dissolved oxygen is in the river.
Right.
So I don't know if that's answering your question. They're bad. I mean, right. They're bad. They're a health hazard. You know, and there are some communities that are taking them on more effectively than others. And Indiana has a long way to go. I think Indiana is the worst offender of any state in this regard.
Right. Now, you mentioned the Yellow River and the Kankakee River as being in your mm-hmm. in your area down in the North Judson area. Now, Knox, you say, has taken the lead and have all their CSO areas offline.
Yep.
Tell us a little bit about the community that you come from and what's going on down there.
It's an interesting story. North Judson has some CSOs, and there's an example of an occasional CSO. They don't have it a lot, I don't believe, but
okay.
They have a unique situation. This kind of tells you that every community, when you look at a question like this, every community system is a little different.
Mm-hmm.
North Judson's kind of unique in the sense that there isn't any surface water drainage in the town at all. North Judson's located in the heart of Indiana's sand country, where almost all water goes underground. Water sinks in the ground, it's very porous, and it comes out through the ground. And the problem that North Judson had with its sewer system was more an infiltration problem, because groundwater continually fed into the sewer system so much that they had a challenge keeping the sewer system working properly, because the water coming into the sewer system would pass effluent requirements.
Okay.
There was so much infiltration from groundwater, and so they had a unique problem. Now, but just as an example, one thing I think for anybody who is involved in the environment, I think one of the things you can do is try to reach out to other people in your community, develop a reputation of honesty and credibility regarding environmental issues, because one thing that happened in the case of North Judson's CSO, North Judson sought and was awarded a grant from the government to do sewer separations. The town's a low-income town. And I got a couple of phone calls from people going, well, is this a boondoggle? Is this a bad idea? Do we need to do this, really? Is this what we should be doing with this money? And I was able to answer their question and say, here's how it's beneficial to us, and here is why it's going to help the town grow, because otherwise the town might have a what's called a sewer ban applied to it.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, one of the tools to make a community get their sewers under control is to say you can't grow until you get this problem solved. So by doing this, North Judson would avoid the prospect of a sewer ban, meaning it could grow. And when I explained this to these people who were community leaders, they were satisfied in the project, and that was a plus to the project. I'm not saying they did it because of that.
Sure,
but
sure.
But they felt, I think, that was, a good explanation for why they should do it. And so I encourage everybody to try to stay in touch with their community leaders and try to develop it to a point where they'll seek your advice in these
mm-hmm.
matters. It's not always easy, because as you know, to be an environmentalist, sometimes you have to be a little confrontational too.
Right, right. And you want to make sure that they still see you as an advocate rather than as an enemy.
Right.
Or somebody that's going to embarrass them. That's a wonderful point, and it's nice to hear that the community moved forward and is doing the best thing for the long-range life of the community. Now, how does agriculture in your area, North Judson, you mentioned that you didn't want a ban down there, you didn't want it a no expansion area. How does the agricultural community in the area relate to the CSO image down there? Is it all sand, or is there an impact from the farming community?
Well, I don't think that the agriculture contributes to CSOs at all, actually. I don't think typically, certainly not in our area. That was purely a situation that's caused by sewers in developed areas. In other words, areas that have a lot of pavement, typically, because that's areas that have storm sewers. What the primary kinds of pollution issues that relate to agriculture, like, there's two kinds in a way. One is the point source type, and the other is the non-point source type. I think the more important, probably, is the latter. Non-point sources are things like farm chemicals that wash off of fields into streams and rivers and are causing problems. Now, first thing I would say is that farmers don't want that to happen.
Right.
Because those things cost money. Even right. if they didn't care about the environment, many do, but even if they didn't care about the environment, they don't want that to happen, but it does happen. And one of the phenomena you'll see if you look at monitoring of streams in our region, not just the Kankakee River, which you know actually does have its headwaters in South Bend, but not just the Kankakee, but just about any river or stream in this area, you'll find that many times water quality actually gets worse as you go to the headwaters as opposed to better. Mm-hmm. And that's probably because small streams have a less capacity to handle this, and many of these problems are caused by runoff from agricultural fields. The other kind of agricultural pollution is point source, which is related to maybe confined animal feeding operations, mm-hmm. that sort of thing. Now, this is something that hasn't come a lot to our community yet, you know, to northern mm-hmm. Indiana, but it could. It may come, and it's sort of the good news and the bad news on that. Is the bad news is they have the capacity to cause much more serious environmental problems. The good news is, though, that point sources are more easily controlled because right. you can monitor a certain location, you can have inspections, and once again, if you support your local regulator,
right.
and they are keeping a watchful eye on that, and you as a citizen need to keep an eye on that, too. Mm-hmm. You know, for example, there was recently a case in Jasper County where there was a manure spill into a creek that IDEM identified that appears to have been going on for a long time, according to IDEM anyway. And it struck me from reading about that shows the importance of citizens, because if a citizen had called IDEM and said, look, we got this creek that looks really bad, I don't know what the problem is, would you come and take a look at it? I'm sure they would,
right.
but they can't proactively monitor every river, creek, lake in Indiana. They can't right. do it, so we need to help them with that.
So the point is get involved. Now many of our viewers love to fish,
yep.
and you mentioned the streams and the rivers, and we're all aware that there are PCBs and mercury levels in the fish that we catch and eat. In fact, I think the little guide that you get when you buy your fishing license tells you that these problems exist. So is a smallie, and I practice catch and release, so I'm going to change the species, is a bluegill that you pull out of the Kankakee River. Is that safe to eat?
Well, that's a good question. And the distinction that you made, there's an important one. You catch
right.
and release smallmouth.
Right.
Smallmouth are higher on the food chain than bluegill somewhat.
Yeah.
And so the higher you go up on the food chain, the more the problem is, typically.
Yeah.
And,
okay.
and so eating fish that are lower on the food chain, you know, this is a hard question. And I have to say the answer ultimately for me is that, sadly enough, I don't anymore.
Right.
I just don't do it. Now, but there's something I'd like to mention about mercury, and I think this is not widely known, and maybe you've talked about it here on the show before, but I saw a poster in courthouse the other day about how you need to be careful to recycle household items that have mercury vapor lights, thermostats, anything that, you know, old thermometers that might have mercury, and that's all really good advice, but I was a little concerned that this is misleading, true but misleading, because the vast majority of our mercury pollution, the source is coal-fired power plant emissions and also to a somewhat lesser extent waste incinerators.
Okay.
Now, this problem is getting worse, and the really unfortunate thing about this problem, I know that one of the things the Greens have is as their watchwords, one of their criteria, precepts, is local action, local control, mm-hmm. local action. The unfortunate thing about the mercury problem, it's coming in the form of rain water, which looks harmless enough, and it's concentrating in the biological material in those bodies of water. And the bad thing about this is local people can't fix that problem. That is a regional problem, many cases across state lines. And that's why we need the federal government to be involved in regulating. There's something you can't do yourself.
Right.
There's something you're going to need your regulators to help you with.
Right.
And the bad news is it's coming from power plants, and we all use electricity and we want power. The good news is, we get back to the point source thing, at least we can point to identifiable sources of the vast majority of
right.
this material. And, you know, if we're all willing to pay maybe, you know, a little more for our our electricity, this problem can be fixed. But because it's something that concentrates in the flesh of animals, up the food chain, it gets heavier and heavier each iteration you go in the food chain. What appears to be a clean lake could be the worst place, because the more oligotrophic a lake is, the less biological material there is in it, the more this mercury is going to concentrate in what is present.
Okay.
And so this is a problem that's happened in Lake Superior before, where you go out in the lake, you could literally go in the middle of the lake, pull a glass of water out of the lake and drink it. I've done it, actually.
Right.
But the fish have concentrations of chemicals that have come in and rain, and this just goes to show that we've got a problem here with environmental pollution that goes beyond local action. That requires,
right,
at least regional and maybe international action.
Now, do states, in other words, if it comes from a coal-firing power plant 100 miles away, goes into the air, rain brings it back down on us, do states monitor the PCB mercury or the mercury levels, and then do they have the authority under any current mandates to do anything about it?
Well, I don't think that right now federal government, the state governments have authority to do anything. I could be wrong about that. I'm not an expert in air pollution, to be honest with you. I know that the federal government hasn't acted in terms of creating maximum mercury emissions, and I know that I'm sure the power plant companies are against it, but it's something that is going to grow in the environment, and it's not going to get better until there's action taken to reduce the inputs, and it's not going to get better real fast even then.
Yeah.
It's somewhat pervasive.
Okay. Wow, that's this certainly is plenty of food for thought for all of us out there, and we certainly want to thank you, Marty, for coming out today. It's nice to know that there is somebody out there who takes these issues to heart. And Marty, before we wrap up today, I want to give you an opportunity to both address our TV audience and also to tell them how they can get in touch with you if they need to.
Well, if you want to get in touch with me, the best way is to write me an email. I think I mentioned before that our farm is named Big Eastern, and my email is Marty, M-A-R-T-Y, at bigeastern.com. That's BIGEASTERN.com. And you can also keep up with environmental issues, especially those relating to watersheds on a regional basis, by visiting my website, the Kankakee River Log, and that's at www.bigeastern.com/Kankakee, or simply type into Google or any other search engine, Kankakee River Log, and you'll find it. And I hope you'll get a chance to use it, and feel free to send email about topics that you're interested in. We keep an open forum for any responsible point of view, whether they're pro-environment or actually against. So do get involved at the local level. That's very important.
Right. Well, thank you. We are so lucky to have Marty join us here today. I can't tell you how much I've learned. That it makes me want to do more catch and release with big pike and bass, but I do still enjoy the little bluegill and the perch. But Marty, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Dave.
This is Green TV News. I'm David Kaiser. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we'll see you all next time. Bye now.
Happy and green. You seem to blend in with so many ordinary everyday things. People tend to pass you by because you're not